greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The Philippines reports 14,895 new COVID cases, the second highest daily tally reported since the pandemic began.
A Philippine senator questions the health department over its purchase of overpriced face masks and face shields through the procurement service arm of the budget department.
The Philippine government plans to release digital COVID-19 vaccination certificates by early September.
And Afghanistan's president stands by his decision to leave the country as the Taliban took over the capital.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crew.
And I'm Denise Densai.
You're watching Top Story. The Philippines reports 14,895 new COVID infections today. That's the second highest daily tally since the pandemic started. This brings the total caseload close to 1.8 million, of which more than 111,000 are active. The health department also reports 258 more COVID-related deaths, the seventh highest reported in a day. New recoveries are at 8,248. The Philippines' Senate Minority Leader questions the Health Department for transferring 42 billion pesos in pandemic funds to the procurement service arm of the budget department. Senator Franklin Drilon points out the DOH, through the procurement service, made questionable purchases, including overpriced face shields and face masks. He says each of those face shields costs around 120 pesos.
The procurement service is the one engaged by the different national government agencies to purchase the supplies which are allocated to the to them under the budget. In this particular case, the DOH assigned for purchases 42 billion pesos of its budget to procurement service of the DBM, headed by Christopher Lau, for which medical supplies for the COVID-19 were purchased, among which were face masks and face shields. And this is where the mystery starts. What we're pointing out, however, that there is a gross overpricing of the face masks and the face shields.
Of the 42 billion pesos, Drilon says around 12 billion pesos remain unspent. He adds a person who authorized the fund transfer must be identified.
Who is the official who directed the transfer of 42 billion? 42 billion being given to the procurement service is something unusual. A government official would be afraid to do this unless directed by somebody higher, and this is what we want to find out.
The Philippines' Department of Budget and Management insists it is not to blame for the delayed release of benefits to healthcare workers. During Wednesday's Senate hearing, health officials pointed fingers at the DBM, claiming the agency did not release enough money. But the DBM says the health department requested for 32 billion pesos when the allocation for it was only at 13.5 billion. The budget department could no longer release more funds for health workers' benefits as its enabling law, the Bayanihan to Recover as One, has expired.
Naapektuhan dito ay yung mismong healthcare workers. Pero dahil dun sa delay na yon, syempre equivalent ng 2 billion pesos na mga allowances ang hindi narilisan, ay hindi na-release, at ganun din ang dami siguro ng tao kung ilan yon.
The health department gives its assurance it will look for ways to fund the special risk allowance for Filipino health workers. Health Undersecretary Leopoldo Vega says the agency may get the funds from its own savings. But if the money is still not enough, then the DOH may ask for help from the Budget and Management Department. Vega adds the DOH is asking its regional offices for a new list of medical workers who have yet to receive their special risk allowance.
Alam namin na talagang meron talagang naiwanan, no? Meron talagang hindi na validate, hindi nabigay yung pangalan. At sinasabi naman namin sa lahat ng mga regional offices, kung pwede, if they can write the regional offices, whether it's an LGU hospital or a private hospital, para tingnan namin yung validated list nila, yung panibago, at saka hanapin namin ang pondo.
On Wednesday, Health Secretary Francisco Duque III denied responsibility for the delayed release of special benefits for pandemic health workers. He said hospitals should be the ones held accountable for the delayed disbursement. At least one group is saying the delayed release of special risk allowance and hazard pay of health workers was due to the bureaucratic system at the DOH. Let's now get more reactions to Secretary Duque's remarks. We now have Dr. Jaime Almora, the president of the Philippine Hospital Association. Dr. Almora, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
We now have Secretary Duque passing the blame on to private hospitals for the delayed release of allowances and benefits of healthcare workers. How does this make you feel?
Yung delay, hindi natin pwedeng i-blame sa mga private hospital lang. Kasi what we should do instead is to look at what transpired. Ano ba yung nangyari? Ano yung timeline itong mga kaganapan na ito? So, we can start looking at what happened after the issuance of the Bayanihan to recover as one app. The DOH came up with Administrative Order Number 36, dated November 16, 2020, and after which, on November 25, that is 9 days after they came up with that administrative order, which is to authorize the continued grant of COVID-19 special risk allowance to public and private health workers directly catering to or in contact with COVID-19 patients during the state of national emergency. On November 25, they came up with a joint circular with DBM, DOH and DBM, joint circular number 2, okay, which is providing the guidelines on the grant of COVID-19 special risk allowance to eligible health workers respectively. So, nandyan na yung guideline, November 25.
Okay.
But it was only, and that the special risk allowance is supposed to cover December to April 30. What happened was, after that guideline was made, it was only in April 27, 3 days before the deadline, that the Undersecretary for Administration and Final Management of DOH came up with Department Memorandum Order Number 02-2021-0210. And as a result of which, kasi ito na yung submission of eligible number of health workers for the grant of COVID-19 active hazard duty pay and COVID-19 special risk allowance. 3 days before the deadline, naglabas ng order for the submission of eligible number.
Mm-hmm.
And I tried to investigate what actually happened. I learned that in one hospital in my region, the personnel from the provincial DOH office went to that hospital at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, bringing with him a flash drive, hindi pa printed copy, but flash drive of this Memorandum Department Circular 2021-0210, 2 hours before 5 o'clock, so at 3 o'clock in the afternoon,
mm-hmm,
of April 30, the day of the deadline itself. So what happened was, there was a rush to submit the list of the personnel. And because the deadline of April 30 is at 12 o'clock midnight, the resource officer of that hospital was able to submit at 10 o'clock at night. So nabit niya yung deadline. Now, after which, after a few days na finalo up, sabi, palitan mo ito, tanggalin mo itong mga ibang personnel. So mag-submit ka ulit. So tinanggap niya yung isang personnel, nag-submit. Nung sinubmit niya, pinatanggal na naman yung ibang personnel. Until naka-apat na balik na ang naiwan na lang one half of the hospital personnel. So that is acceptable.
Doctor, so, bakit pinatanggal yung mga ibang pangalan? Dahil hindi sila eligible?
Dahil sila direct patient. Wala siyang direct contact sa patient.
Okay, so yung sinabit ng mga pangalan, ano po yun? Lahat ng personnel ng hospital na yon. Tapos sila pinabawasan ang pinabawasan.
Sila ang pumili. Kasi sa amin, lahat yan, exposed lahat yan. Pero silang bahalang ito lang. Ganun.
Mm-hmm.
So, nakaapat na balik. Of course, lumagpas na sa April 30 yan. Now, nagkaroon ng amendment doon sa Administrative Order na 36. Nagkaroon ng amendment which is dated June 1. Ito yung Administrative Order 42 galing sa DOH extending yung deadline ay yung coverage that instead of December to April, naging naging December to June. In-include na niya yung May and June. Okay? So, na-extend yun with the circular. Now, may submit naman yung mga na-comply. May-submit yung mga listahan. However, on July 16, which is 16 days after yung deadline ng June 30, nakatanggap yung hospital na yon ng advisory galing sa regional office ng DOH. If I may read para maglagay sa tamang context. To development management officers, private and public hospitals, local government units in the region. This is in relation to a special risk allowance of eligible health workers per administrative order 36 dated 16 November 2020 as amended by administrative order number 42 dated June 1, 2020. Best efforts through emails, phone calls, and short messaging system were carried out to acquire necessary requirements from LGUs, local government units, hospitals, and other health facilities. A deadline of submission of necessary requirements to the region per signed advisory dated 23 June 2021 was set on 25 June 2021 and then extended to 28 June 2021. So the deadline should be 25 June and extend ng 28 mm-hmm. June. Their management committee meeting, however, some facilities were unable to meet the deadline. Obligation requests and disbursement vouchers accommodating all payrolls forwarded up to 30 of June 2021 were processed for disbursement, which consequently led to not reaching the bank system's cut-off. Ano pong ibig sabihin nun? Na-receive nila yung galing sa hospitals dahil in-extend nila yung deadline.
Na-receive nila lahat ng pangalan.
Pero prinasis nila yung voucher para ibigay sa bank.
Okay.
Kaso inabutan sila ng cut-off ng bank ng June 30. Okay, ito yung sumunod. Please be informed that we have requested central office for the release of the lapse funds. It was learned that central office will request from DBM, but the release of funds will need the approval of the office of the president. Okay, so dahil nag-lapse noong June 30, nagsumulat itong region na ito doon sa central office. At ang central office nagpunta sa DBM para humingi ng pundo, para hingin ng pundo dahil nalapsan yun eh, automatic na na-revert back. Pero sabi ng DBM, kailangan ng pirma ng presidente. So alin po yung nakikita natin dito ngayon? Wala pong kasalanan ng hospital dito. Kahit na to the last minute, to the last hour, na-comply nila. Dahil late na late yung pagbigay ng notice. Remember, deadline in April 30, dumating yung, ginawa lang yung order sa central office ng April 27. Nakarating lang sa provincial right. office 3 hours that day, to the day of the deadline. But 3 hours, let's say kung 5 o'clock yung office hours, 2 hours before the end right. of office hour, 3 o'clock in the afternoon, doon pa lang dinala sa hospital. Pero technically, mag-i-end yan sa 12 o'clock midnight. So hinabol hanggang sa alas 10 ng gabi.
Right, Dr. Almora. So,
maraming pinaka-comply dahil nga late yung pagbigay nila. Kaya in-extend nila ito hanggang June 30.
Yes.
Circular. Ganun pa rin, hindi naman nakaabot sa cut-off ng bangko dahil sa preparation ng mga documents. Ngayon, na-revert back yung pundo, hindi naman i-release yung DBM kung hindi magpirma yung Office of the President. Ano nga ba nangyari sa Office of the President?
Yun nga rin po ang tatanong ko, ano pong impormasyon ang nakuha nyo kung bumalik doon sa Office of the President? Napirmahan ho ba? Nabigyan ayun ng go signal para ilabas? Wala na po kayong balita doon?
Wala na po kaming balita na.
But for your part, you're saying members of the Philippine Hospital Association, or at least that hospital that you were referring to, completed all the requirements. Wala pong kasalanan na nagawa po lahat, nabigay po lahat ng requirements. Nagkaroon po ng problema sa DOH, sa banko, sa DBM, at nag-iintay po kayo ng balita na galing sa Office of the President para may labas po yung budget ulit. Okay. Ang sinasabi po kasi ni Secretary Duque mula nung September 2020, na ilabas na po ang total ng mga 15 billion pesos. So, dinodouble check ko lang po. What you're saying is the funds that are allotted for the benefits and allowances of your health workers are not with your hospitals yet.
Wala pa po.
Wala pa po. Ganun pa rin po, nag-iintay pa rin po ng problema. Wala na po bang kailangan ibang daanan? Kasi po, nakausap po ng ABS-CBN ng PHAP, si Dr. Jose De Grano. May binabanggit po siya na yung iba, dumadaan pa po yung pondo, dumadaan pa po sa local governments. Meron din po bang ganung kwento ang mga members nyo sa PHA na ang pagkakaalam po namin proseso is galing sa gobyerno, didiretso po sa private hospitals para mabigay sa healthcare workers. Meron pa po bang ibang mga areas na dumadaan sa ibang ahensya, lalo na po sa LGU?
Hindi po ako sanay sa how they handle funds sa government. Mm-hmm. Pero based on yung tinignan ko ng mga records, ay hindi naman dapat dadaan sa local government.
Okay.
Except yung mga local government hospitals, doon pupunta yung mga hospital ng local government.
Tama, naiintindihan po namin. Pero sa private hospitals, kailangan diretso po sa private hospitals yon, tapos diretso sa mga health workers. Meron po ba kayong data kung gaano po kadami ang hindi pa nakaka-receive ng SRA nila and other benefits doon sa mga miyembro nyo?
Marami po ako nakakausap na hindi nakaka-receive, pero wala po ako talaga yung...
Wala po kayo ng numbers talaga. Opo. Dr. Almora, naririnig niyo naman po siguro yung usapan. Madami na pong naiinip, madami pong nagagalit sa hirap ng dinadanas nila at wala pa pong nakukuhang pondo at benepisyo mula doon sa government na iniintay nila. Yung iba po ay nag-threaten na po, nagsasabi na po na baka magkaroon ng mass resignation. Ano pong nararamdaman niyo doon?
It came at the worst time naman kasi ito. Kasi hindi lang naman itong SRA ang problema. Problema pa rin pati yung ngayon payment sa reimbursement sa COVID cases from PhilHealth.
Mm-hmm.
Talagang naging kawawang-kawawa lang naman. Lahat na, workers, yung hospital, yung mga doctors, talaga namang napagkaitan na gusto. Binubuwis na nila yung buhay nila. Lahat ng effort nandiyan. Tapos, ganyan pa mangyayari. Okay lang sana kung sinabing walang ibibigay, di okay, pero pag nagbigay na sa iba tapos hindi nakatanggap yung iba, masakit naman sa iba.
Naintindihan po namin yon. Pero na kayo po bang mga doktor, pati po yung mga private hospitals ay nagkausap-usap na po dun sa posibilidad na magkaroon ng mass leave or mass resignation ang mga healthcare workers? Nagpaplano po ba kayo ng contingency kung mangyari nga po yun?
Hindi naman lahat ng hospital ng health workers ng hospital siguro. Depende sa lugar yan.
Mm-hmm.
At kaya parang lang, case to case na lang sa mga hospital yan. Kung gano'n na mangyayari sa isang hospital, wala talaga magagawa yung hospital. Ang magsasuffer yung mga pasyente, kasi yung hospital, hindi naman magsasuffer yan. Magsasuffer yung mga pasyente.
Dr. Almora, doon sa binigay niyo pong senaryo kanina na pagka medyo may pagkahaba-haba, no? Ilang circulars na release ng DOH, pero sa dulo din po napunta, wala rin pong lumabas na pera. Ano po bang, mayroon po ba kayong suggestion kung paano mas mapapaayos yung sistema para mapabilis na itong paglabas ng pondo at para umabot na po sa mga healthcare workers yung mga allowances at benepisyo nila?
Wala po kasi nasa government system na yan ng financial management. Alam naman natin na ganyan talaga lumakad ang sistema sa gobyerno dahil everything has to be based on guidelines, on laws. Minsan may mga factors naman na nakakapigil yung paggalaw ng papel, pero yung mga humahawak ng papel hindi naman makapagsalita dahil pagsabihin nila yung totoong kwento may masasagasaan sila na boss nila. So hindi na lang, tumahimik na lang sila, you end up hindi mo alam ano nangyari, pero may dahilan yan.
Dr. Jaime Almora, the President of the Philippine Hospital Association. Maraming maraming salamat po.
Maraming salamat din.
Philippine government auditors have flagged more supposed irregularities in the country's embattled health department. The commission and audit called out what it says are unnecessary and excessive expenditures of the health department's regional office. The expenses in question, worth over 557 million pesos. Among these expenditures, catering services for virtual meetings amounting to over 1 million pesos in DOH Region 6's Center for Health Development. Another was more than 2 million pesos in hazard payments allegedly made to hospital personnel who did not physically report to work or were not qualified. COA also mentioned the non-utilization of the agency's Marawi City crisis funds amounting to 58.9 million pesos. COA's 2020 audit report on the DOH also included the agency's alleged mismanagement of 67 billion pesos in COVID response funds, which lawmakers are now scrutinizing. After drawing backlash, Police Chief Guillermo Eleazar retracts his statement against the commission and audit. On Wednesday, Eleazar suggested COA should stop releasing its audit reports to the media. But Eleazar now says it was made clear to him that the agency does not issue press statements and instead posts its audit reports on its website for transparency. He also says the PNP takes COA's observations seriously. Eleazar adds he instructed his subordinates to further improve their coordination with state auditors.
The Duterte administration should not be going after the Commission on Audit since it is a natural ally in the president's thrust to resolve corruption. That's according to Attorney Domingo Cayosa, former president of the Integrated Bar of the Philippines. He says Duterte should instead empower COA to perform its constitutional mandate if he's really bent on resolving corruption. Attorney Cayosa also rejects Health Secretary Duque's claim COA's audit report was unfair and unjust.
This happens to everyone else. He's not picked out for this audit. All of these yearly reports are done for all agencies and everything is uploaded on the COA website. That's transparency for us. Remember, transparency is a constitutional mandate. It's even one of the initial policies of this administration. So we cannot, no one should complain about these public records uploaded in the website.
Malacanang says there are just two options for Metro Manila's next quarantine status: extend the enhanced community quarantine or downgrade to modified ECQ. The hard lockdown imposed in Metro Manila will expire on Friday, August 20th. Mayors in the capital region have said they will leave the decision on whether or not to extend the lockdown to the interagency task force. Presidential spokesperson Harry Roque says President Rodrigo Duterte may announce a new quarantine status on Friday.
Dalawang option lang naman po yan, mananatilang ECQ, in which case ang tanong, meron bang pang-ayuda? Or ibababa po sa MECQ. Dalawa lang po yan. Pero ang nais kong sabihin sa ating taong bayan, pangatlong ECQ na po natin to. At nakikita natin na matapos ang ECQ, hindi po kaagad bumababa ang numero. Siguro po mga isang linggo pa bago tuluyang bumaba. Dahil nga po delayed yung reaction because it takes 14 days yung cycle ng hawahan sa sakit neto. So hindi po ibig sabihin na kung matatapos na ang ECQ ay bukas bababa. Hindi po. Never na naging ganun ang ating karanasan sa naunang ECQ na dalawang beses na nating in-impose.
COVID-19 vaccinations in Metro Manila have improved during the implementation of the enhanced community quarantine. That's according to COVID-19 Task Force Deputy Chief Implementer Vince Dizon. Daily inoculations in the National Capital Region are averaging at around 180,000 doses. But it is still short of the 250,000 target set by the Metro Manila Council. As for the nationwide COVID-19 testing, Dizon says the numbers have also increased.
Right now po, ang average natin itong nakaraang pitong araw ay 60,000 tests per day. Ito ay tumaas na itong mga nakaraang mga linggo. Noong una po ay nag-average lang tayo ng mga 50,000 per day. Kulang pa rin po ito, pero marami tayong mga paghahamon ngayon. Ngayon po, ang magiging malaking challenge po natin is kailangan po tayong makipag-ugnayan sa ating Philippine Health Insurance Corporation dahil kailangan din pong ma-reimburse ng ating mga laboratorio nung kanilang mga tinetest, lalo na sa mga kwalipikadong mga kababayan natin na libre dapat ang testing.
COVID-19 vaccine manufacturers Moderna and AstraZeneca have suspended accepting vaccine orders through multi-party agreements. That's according to COVID-19 vaccination chief Carlito Galvez. He says manufacturers would rather have direct transactions with the national government instead of private firms going through several channels before they can purchase their own jabs. Galvez also denying claims government's inaction on tripartite agreements is causing delays in the country's vaccine rollout.
Hindi naman sa ganun reality check, tingnan natin. Mahirap yung ano yung kontrata na halos imagine 300 ang magiging signatories sa Western North. That's a very complicated matter. Mahirapan sila. They want a simple contract.
The Philippine government is eyeing to release digital COVID-19 vaccination certificates by early September. Undersecretary Emmanuel Kaintik of the Department of Information and Communications Technology says these certificates follow standards from the World Health Organization and will be honored overseas. An online platform will be open to public where people will input their vaccination details. Data for these certificates will be protected through private encryption.
Hintay-hintay lang konti, okay na ang system, handa na siya sana at naka-integrate na ito sa World Health Organization countries.
The Chinese government will donate 1 million more doses of Sinopharm COVID vaccines to the Philippines. In a Facebook post, Ambassador Wang Xilian said the vaccines will arrive on Friday and Saturday. Back in June, the Food and Drug Administration approved the Health Department's application to receive Sinopharm's jabs that were donated to the country. The Philippines, meanwhile, is expecting the arrival of 3 million more Sinovac doses procured by the government tonight.
Australia's largest city, Sydney, ramps up COVID-19 vaccinations as the country's number of new cases hits a record high. Australia reported 754 new infections Thursday, the highest since the pandemic began, 681 of which came from the state of New South Wales. At least 52% of residents in the state have received at least one dose of a COVID vaccine. But state authorities want 70% of the population vaccinated before the current lockdown in Sydney ends. Over in neighboring New Zealand, authorities reported 11 new cases Thursday. This brings the total number of infections in the island's latest outbreak to 21. Authorities have traced the outbreak to a citizen who traveled from Sydney earlier this month.
U.S. President Joe Biden is defending the administration's push to provide booster shots to all adult Americans. U.S. federal health officials announced Wednesday booster shots would be made widely available to Americans beginning September 20th. That's after U.S. government researchers said COVID-19 vaccine efficacies have dropped since the Delta variant became dominant in the country.
Now, there are some world leaders who say America shouldn't get a third shot until other countries got their first shot. I disagree. We can take care of America and help the world at the same time. In June and July, America administered 50 million shots here in the United States, and we donated 100 million shots to other countries. That means that America has donated more vaccine to other countries than every other country in the world combined.
The World Health Organization reiterated its call for a halt to booster doses. A senior advisor to the WHO says there are enough vaccines around the world, but they are not going to the right places. The WHO now wants high-income countries to channel their excess shots to low-income nations.
because Delta is so much more transmissible, we do see these breakthrough infections occurring in people who've received both vaccines. But if you look at the outcomes that we're really concerned about, which is severe disease, hospitalization, and death, those are clearly being prevented by the vaccines, and that's true for Delta as well.
Healthcare workers in South Korea warn of holding demonstrations next month amid a brewing COVID crisis there. Medical workers there are ordered to work only for 2 hours in a protective suit, but their shifts usually exceed up to 4 hours. Health workers also call on the South Korean government to provide a special risk compensation and to put a cap on the patients assigned to each nurse. The General Union plans to launch a strike on September 2 if their negotiations with the government will not materialize.
Up ahead, Afghan President Ashraf Ghani defends his decision to leave his country while the Taliban took over its capital.
And the Philippines' largest business group urges government to rethink its use of lockdowns to address COVID-19. More news when we return.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
We'll be right back.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have...
Welcome back. You're still watching Top Story. Afghan President Ashraf Ghani finally emerges days after he fled Kabul as the Taliban took over the capital. He says he left the country to prevent bloodshed. His comments come as U.S. President Joe Biden says American troops may stay in Afghanistan beyond the deadline. Here's the full story.
Afghanistan's president has defended his decision to leave the country, saying on Wednesday he had to do so to prevent bloodshed. Ashraf Ghani has been bitterly criticized for flying out on Sunday as Taliban forces entered Kabul. In his first public comments from exile in the UAE, Ghani also denied reports that he had taken large sums of money with him.
All my colleagues in the West told me that if I didn't leave, things would be worse. I could have stayed and started a war, but I had a responsibility to my people, and I didn't want to start a bloodbath like in Syria and Yemen. If I had stayed, I would have been executed.
Meanwhile, thousands of diplomats, foreign citizens, and ordinary Afghans are trying to leave the country. Since the weekend, Kabul's airport has played host to scenes of chaos as crowds try to flee, fearing a return to the Taliban's hardline rule. Guns were fired into the air near crowds of people on Wednesday. Witnesses said armed members of the Taliban were preventing people from reaching the airport, including those with the necessary documents to travel. There are still 4,500 US troops in the country, but their mission is mainly focused on securing the airfield. At a Pentagon press briefing, US Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin said they could not expand their operations.
We cannot afford to either not defend that airfield or not have an airfield that's secure where we have hundreds or thousands of civilians that can access the airfield at will and put our forces at risk.
But that doesn't answer the question. I mean, you're still saying you're focused on the airfield. These people can't get into the airfield.
Well, we're going to do everything we can to continue to try to deconflict and create passageways for them to get to the airfield. I don't have the capability to go out and extend operations currently into Kabul.
President Joe Biden says the U.S. troops may remain in Afghanistan beyond the 31st of August deadline to evacuate American citizens. In an interview with ABC, Biden defended his handling of the withdrawal, suggesting there was no way to get out without chaos ensuing.
A new government in the form of a ruling council could soon rise in Afghanistan. Taliban Supreme Leader Haibatullah Akhundzada will most likely be at the helm. A senior member of the militant group says they will reach out to former pilots and soldiers of the Afghan armed forces to join the council. The Taliban leader adds Afghanistan would be governed by Islam's legal system.
The system of the government is clear. That is an Islamic government. Sharia law would be, of course, there would be no democratic system at all because it doesn't have any base in our country.
A group of Afghan women remains defiant despite the threat of a brutal rule by the Taliban. They say the Taliban should walk the talk and uphold their vow of respecting the rights of women.
A group of Afghan women holding signs and protesting for their rights on the streets of Kabul. Women and girls in Afghanistan are desperate not to lose their freedoms now that the Taliban are back in power. Afghan activist Pashtana Durrani runs an organization that provides access to learning materials for 7,000 girls, mostly in rural areas across Afghanistan.
As an Afghan woman, I wouldn't trust them because they don't have a very clear good track record of being keeping up their promises or something like that. And the Taliban should give a statement out that all these girls should be going to all these public schools. Schools and no foot soldiers are allowed to harass them or target them or stop them. And then they should continue the way they are studying, right? If they're okay with all that, we're good to go. Then I'm optimistic, but they have to walk the talk. Right now, they're not doing that.
In their first press conference in Kabul, the Taliban pledged to respect women's right to work and education, but only within the framework of Islamic law.
Women will be afforded all their rights.
The UN Children's Agency, UNICEF, expressed cautious optimism about working with Taliban officials, citing their early expressions of support for girls' education. But many others remain skeptical. Several women were ordered to leave their jobs during the Taliban's rapid advance across the country, and activists say they want to see the Taliban held to account for any commitment. During their rule from 1996 to 2001, guided by Sharia religious law, girls were not allowed to go to school, women could not work, and had to wear burqas to go outside.
Philippine shares bucked the downward trend among most Asian markets. But as Ray Musni tells us, some investors opted to stay on the sidelines ahead of the announcement of new quarantine classifications for the country.
Philippine shares extended its winning streak to a fourth day, bucking the regional slide. The main index notched up over 0.5% back to the 6,700 level, while foreign funds resumed their buying spree. But trades were thin, as most investors stayed on the sidelines while awaiting the decision of the Interagency Task Force on Infectious Diseases on whether it would extend the lockdown in Metro Manila and other areas. Regina Capital Development says the market digested news of the Development Budget Coordinating Committee cutting the full-year economic growth for the country and the minutes of the U.S. Federal Reserve meeting signaling plans to taper off asset purchases by the end of the year. AAA Equities President Matthew Cabangon says despite timing and trends pointing to a correction, many stocks are still undervalued, so investors should keep looking for those bargains for long-term gain.
As I said earlier, it's a bifurcated market. Now, it's the question whether should we be contrarian now? Should we be selling the winners and buying the losers? And I would argue no. As you mentioned earlier, right, we might be seeing extensions of lockdowns. That really only extends the current paradigm, and there's really no sign that it's reversing. So my advice to investors, keep betting on the winners.
Holdings firms led the charge again, while the industrials and services sectors took the pie for value of trades. Mining and oil continued their descent. Rain Musngi, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry says government should rethink its use of lockdowns to curb the spread of COVID-19. Acting President Edgardo Lacson says one day of lockdown costs businesses at least 10.7 billion pesos, citing government figures. He adds authorities should instead explore other measures, such as ramping up the country's vaccination rollout.
The same measures. We cannot expect a different result. It will be the same. There will be more closures.
Banking giant HSBC under fire over accusations of racism from a former employee. Here's the full story.
George Floyd was a real awakening for me, and it was for many people. And it made me reevaluate my career in the bank.
Ian Clark resigned from HSBC over alleged racism, frustrated at the speed and scale of the bank's response to a report he wrote alleging racism within its ranks. He says banks are failing to deliver on promises to hire, retain and promote more black executives, as prejudice and a reluctance to change stymie leaders' good intentions. Born to a white mother and Jamaican father in London, Clark was drawn to banking because of the opportunity it offered people without privilege. He enrolled in HSBC's management training scheme in 2008 and rose through the ranks. His report, Project Speak Up, looks at the state of diversity within HSBC, based on interviews with around 100 colleagues.
The bank keeps these numbers very closely guarded, but the numbers that I uncovered suggested that we had just 90 black leaders in our firm of 226,000 globally. 90 black people in 226,000 across 65 countries, five of which are majority black countries. And that number has significantly reduced since then, currently estimated to be about 60 black leaders remaining within HSBC Group today.
While he welcomed the bank's initial response to the report, Clark says he became disillusioned by the pace of change. Of the 11 black and minority people in his sales team, he says 9 have left HSBC in the last 3 years and none have joined to replace them. HSBC didn't comment on this. It comes at a time when banks worldwide say they're trying to implement pledges to improve diversity. After the murder of George Floyd in police custody in the United States in May 2020 sparked global protests over racial injustice. HSBC, Europe's biggest bank, said in July 2020 it aimed to double the number of black staff in senior roles by 2025. CEO Noel Quinn told Reuters recently the lender saw no need to restate that target. Clark, however, says the bank is unlikely to achieve that goal under its current direction and that the problem runs throughout the industry.
More to come, drug personality Kerwin Espinosa and several others face raps for violation of the Comprehensive Dangerous Drugs Act. Stay with us.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Welcome back. Philippine authorities indict high-profile drug personality Kerwin Espinosa and several others for violation of the Comprehensive Dangerous Drugs Act. Mike Navallo reports.
A Department of Justice panel of prosecutors has indicted alleged drug lord Kerwin Espinosa of conspiracy to commit illegal drug trading over his alleged illegal drug activities spanning various cities across the years before his arrest in 2016. The panel, led by Senior Assistant State Prosecutors Charlie Guhit and Susan Azarcon, found probable cause to charge Espinosa and 10 others of violating Section 26 of the Comprehensive Dangerous Drugs Act. The 42-page resolution was dated July 23, but was only made public today. Indicted with Espinosa were his former aide-turned-government witness Marcelo Adorco, Jose Antipuesto, Jose Estrera, Galo Stephen Bubares, Ferdinand Duandina, Brian Anthony Zaldivar, Nick June Canin, Verbi Cadellano, Alfred Batistes, and Josela Dumaguit. Although there were no illegal drugs recovered, the indictment was based on the extrajudicial confessions of the respondents and their communications. All of them have issued affidavits where they admitted their participation in the illegal drug trade, which the panel of prosecutors considered as evidence against them. Espinosa, the son of the late Albuera Leyte Mayor Rolando Espinosa, who was killed inside a jail in Baybay Leyte in November 2016, confessed that he began his illegal drug trade in Cebu and continued it even when he was under detention at various facilities like the Bagong Buhay Rehabilitation Center in Cebu and the New Bilibid Prison in Muntinlupa in 2009. He said he even transacted with a police officer from 2013 to 2016. The panel prosecutor said that the confessions of Espinosa and the others were sufficient and admissible as evidence. But it is not clear from the indictment which years and which transactions were particularly covered by the indictment. Espinosa had previously been indicted also for drug trading with alleged drug lord Peter Ko in July 2018. The panel relied on a Supreme Court ruling in a drug case against detained Senator Laila De Lima, where the High Court ruled that it is not necessary to present the drug itself in illegal drug trading cases. And the panel said that because of the complexity of the transactions, it is enough to rely on communications presented to the panel. There are no indications from the indictment if this case is in any way related to the drug cases that De Lima is facing. She is facing two conspiracies to commit illegal drug trading in connection with supposed illegal drug trade at the MDP, despite the absence of any illegal drugs recovered. A Muntinlupa court jumped a third case against her in February this year.
Our news overseas, the U.S. will limit some flights from Chinese carriers to 40% passenger capacity for weeks after Beijing imposed similar restrictions on four United Airlines flights. More in this report.
The U.S. Transportation Department slapped limits on Chinese airlines on Wednesday, following a similar move by Beijing. The order will limit U.S.-China flights on four different Chinese airlines to 40% capacity for at least a month. China told United Airlines earlier this month it would be imposing sanctions after five passengers who traveled from San Francisco to Shanghai allegedly tested positive for COVID-19. The U.S. government says China's circuit breaker policy violates the nation's air services agreement, placing, quote, undue culpability on carriers for travelers testing positive for COVID-19. They added that carriers have no means to independently verify positive test results alleged by Chinese authorities or determine where or when a traveler contracted the virus. United said it was pleased to see the U.S. taking action, quote, in pursuit of fairness in this important market. The Chinese embassy in Washington did not immediately comment. The two countries' agreement allows more than 100 weekly flights back and forth, although only a fraction of those are currently operating. The U.S. and China have sparred over flight services since the beginning of the pandemic. The latest limits come as many Chinese students head to the U.S. for the start of fall classes.
Another humanitarian crisis unfolding in Haiti in a wake of a powerful tremor that struck last Saturday. Hospitals in the quake-hit region of Lake are overflowing with people in need of treatment. Patients have spilled over to corridors and tents that were put up outside crumbling hospital buildings. The official death toll now stands at 2,189. Impatience also growing among survivors over the sluggish arrival of relief supplies. The Civil Protection Agency says they are working to deliver aid to at least 600,000 people. Haiti is still recovering from a 2010 quake that killed over 200,000 individuals. The nation was also plunged into political turmoil following the assassination of its president in July. And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Dinsai.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thank you for watching.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.